Previously on Joseph Sylvia's Childhood Fears, Joseph talked about five NFL teams that do not belong in their current division. Today, on this special edition of Joseph Sylvia's Childhood Fears, he is going to talk about 13 things that scared him. What are those 13 things? Let's find out. And now, here is the man that's going to talk to you about his childhood fears, Joseph Sylvia. Hello, everyone. This is Joseph Sylvia, aka the WCVB 5 fan here. And welcome to the special Halloween edition of Joseph Sylvia's Childhood Fears. As you all know, Halloween is a holiday where people scare each other, but also give treats. So today, my treat to you guys on Halloween is the top 13 things that scared me as a kid. For this list, we're only going to focus on the things that I can show you with caution, of course, for obvious reasons. And we're going to we'll look at each clip that scared me out first. So anyway, and I'll explain why they scared me. Anyway, what are the 13 things, the top 13 things that scared me? Let's find out. These are the top 13 things that scared me. Here we go. Number 13, the baby son diminuendo scream. Before I start that, I do want to share some fun facts. As many of you know, Jessica Smith was the face of the baby son seen here. Actually, let me move into the theater mode. Here we go. See, that's the face of Jess Smith. Here's something that many of you may not have known. All of the baby son clips that Jess did were recorded at Pinewood Studios on Thursday, June 20th, 1996. I'm not kidding. I actually read this on Jess Smith's Instagram channel. She shows a letter that proves that said, please come to Pinewood Studios on the 20th of June, 1996. That's how they say in the UK, the dates. So that's how I know. It was filmed during the morning, UK time during those hours. So in the US, at least in my coast, it was actually in everybody's coast in the US, it was filmed overnight. But let's begin. So the diminuendo scream, for this clip, I'm going to use credit goes to Fabian Smita Quarter 2001 for uploading the US version of Silly Songs and Funny Dances, which has this clip at the end of the, right before Tell Me Bye Bye, after the Dizzy Dance extended version. Let's listen to the baby son diminuendo scream. Yep. Now, a lot of people were scared of this clip the most, but me and Jordan Knight's fanboy will, we're scared of mostly of another baby son clip, which I'll get to as we get further down the list. Number 12. Baby Bop singing Five Golden Rings in Night Before Christmas. The reason I purposely put this on number 12 because it relates to the 12 days of Christmas. In the first few times she sings Five Golden Rings, as I've said before in Six Things Wrong with Barney's Night Before Christmas, Baby Bop sings Five Golden Rings alone, which I thought was pretty weird. But she did a good job, though. I will say, but Baby Bop, you did a good job. So I will say the way she sang Five Golden Rings the last few times was just a little loud. When I previously talked about this, I showed the part where she sings it after, when they sing the 12, when they count down from 12. This clip, I'm going to do it when they count down from 11 instead, where Robert, played by Angel Velasco, sings that 11 Days of Christmas by True Love gave to me a few times. I mean on his own. And let's listen to Barney's Baby Bop singing here. clip, as you all know, scared me. I mean, so yeah. Number 11. Close-ups in Barney and Friends. Yep, as you all know, we're going to start, for this clip, we're going to start with Barney's Halloween party. Now, this time, I'm going to talk about the scenes themselves. In this scene, after their visit to Farmer Dewey's farm, that background could be used in several episodes, such as E-I-E-I-O, which was the last episode of season 4. Here, we see Hannah, played by Marissa Coors, who's now Marissa Malis, pulling the wagon with the pumpkins they picked from the farm. And we see Stephen wondering what the decorations, who made the decorations. And then we see Mr. Boy, played by Robert Sweatman, dressed as a pirate. And that's when we see a close-up of Barney asking Mr. Boy this question. Listen.
Did you put up all of these decorations, Mr. Boy?
Most of them. I still have some more decorating to do in the gym.
So I thought I'd let Mr. Boyd answer that question for you, in case you were wondering if he put up with the decorations. So, but that close-up of Barney scared me as a kid. The next clip we're going to look at is from Sing and Dance with Barney. In the scene where the kids go camping. And it's after the part where Linda, played by Adrian Kangas, and Kathy, played by Lauren King, sing Me and My Teddy Bear, which was actually Lauren King's signature song because it was about Kathy's teddy. In this clip, we see Robert, played by Angel Blasco. And in fact, I'll talk about him in a little bit. We see Tasha, played by Hope Cervantes, and Hannah again, and Barney as well, looking up at the stars and the moon. And here, that's where Hannah sings Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star. I'm actually going to move the clip here like this. I keep forgetting to do that. Listen. Okay, Marissa, if you're watching this, I'll give you this. You did a good job singing that song. And I will say, I'm not saying it's your fault. It's just the cameramen did not have to zoom in and show a close-up of her, of you. Okay? I just felt it was kind of creepy. Next, we're going to talk, is the scene from Barney's Rhyme Time Rhythm. Hang on a second. I didn't mean to do that. Anyway, here we see Emily, played by Hannah Owens, noticing a shoe. And Mother Goose, played by Barbara, I'll have to put her last name in the description, which, fun fact, was actually one of my, I will share a connection with that name. As a person with type 1 diabetes, off topic, but as this person with type 1 diabetes, one of the 7 public school nurses I had, not counting substitute nurses, was named Barbara. I just thought I'd share that connection with you. So back to topic here. So we see Emily picking up a shoe. Mother Goose sees her doing that, and Mother Goose sees it. And then Barney sees it. Now, this clip also scared me, too. I should have put this on the list, but I'm not going to do that. We see Barney running over, and she hands him the shoe, and we zoom into his stomach, which reminds me of Teletubbies during the TV events. And then we see Robert, Keisha, and Jeff I think that's Jill. I could be wrong, though. And Keisha. And then there's Robert sitting on the crescent, which is the which is what that size of the moon is called. And they sing a song called Winkin', Blinkin', and Nod. And yeah, so I will give it this. This scene was pretty cool. But when it goes back to Mother Goose's studio, I'm just going to call it studio because that's where it was filmed. And we see a close up of Robert, and you'll see in a moment. I know I showed it to you in Six Things Wrong with Barney's Night Before Christmas, but I will show it to you again here in case you don't remember. So yeah, so here's the clip. So here's another thing. So yeah. Yep, there's that close-up of Robert. Again, same thing, similar to what I just told Marissa. Angel, if you're watching this, you did a good job singing that. I loved your singing of it, but I just didn't feel it was necessary for the camera crew to show a close-up of you. And I didn't put this on the list, but I also forgot to mention Raffi. In Raffi and Concert, the Rise and Shine Band, the song where they do a close up of him is the song called De Colores, which is Spanish for all the colors. And I didn't like the close up of him. I still kind of think it's awkward, but yeah. And fun fact, this year marks 35 years since that film. Since that concert was played. Now, let's get back to this list. Hang on a second, guys. This clip's wrong here. Here we go. Number 10. One giant cookie in How Many Cookies Are There Today on Sesame Street, for those that are wondering. Before I show you that that version of the Number of the Day segment, I'm going to show you the number of the day that I remember as a kid, mostly. Well, the first one I remember, the one I remember the most. It's the nostalgic one from 2002 where the count played by the late Jerry Nelson, may he rest in peace, playing a pipe organ, and as he played a note, a pipe organ would say a number, would sing a number. For this clip, I'm gonna go all the way and count to 20, and show you the number of the day 20 segment, because, and I'm gonna do it from the episode 4076, because I do remember seeing that episode, where I remember the letter of the day in that episode, which was G. And spoiler alert, I forgot to mention that Lair of the G segment that was also shown in this episode also scared me when that giant cookie falls down on Cookie Monster. And yeah, but anyway. So let's look at the clip. This is the clip I remember seeing, and this is the clip I always loved. This is my favorite clip out of the Number of the Day segment, pipe organ segments. Or basically any clip with the number of the day being 20. Okay. All right, pipe organs, take it away.
Is mounting.
And there you have it. Those are all 20 pipe organs. Now, this is how the number of the day, how many cookies segments was made. We see Cookie Monster and some other Sesame Street characters that you see here. He sings a rap song about how many cookies will be baked for him, obviously, to eat. And then they dance around, and they stomp as well. And they do it twice, actually. They do shake around twice. And, yeah. This one, I'm not going to play the song because I don't want to... And there's the 20, and we see the count popping up, and then we see the oven opening, revealing the number of cookies, which in this case you see here is 20. Now, that's not the reason why I'm showing you this clip. The reason why I'm showing you this clip is because of the size of cookies on that tray there. Now, if you look here, look closely, when one is the number of the day, we see that giant that giant-sized cookie. That cookie scared me, just like how the Letter of the Day G cookie scared me in the Letter of the Day G segment. So yeah, so Sesame Street, if you want to make the cookie, make sure you make it to the right size, depending on how many numbers, regardless of how many numbers. Well, zero obviously doesn't make any sense, but in zero, the cow just gives him an empty plate, and he eats that instead. So yeah. And speaking of that, the next thing that scared me that I put on this list is another number of the day segment. Here we go. Number 9. The pipe organ sings 7 differently when the said number is the number of the day. So, before I get to that, we already heard how the pipe organ normally, the audio of the pipe saying seven in normally. In here, we hear the number 7 being played differently, the audio of it being heard differently. And I'm going to let you hear, that in a second once 6 is revealed. Listen. See? And I use this clip from episode 4065 because I remember seeing that episode on PBS Kids as well. Mainly because I remember the Ernie scene in this, not the Journey to Ernie segment, the Ernie and Bert segment where actually Bert wasn't even in the segment, where Ernie sits alone on an apple tree and sings a song about him and his apple tree. I think it came out in 1984, but I'm not sure. I could be wrong, though. Anyway, back to the list. Number 8. Mrs. Claus being excited to see Barney in Night Before Christmas. I understand if Mrs. Claus is excited to see Barney. I get it. Now, this one, this and another part, which will, and another, another clip in Barney's Night Before Christmas, which I'll get to in a little bit later on. This clip here, it comes when Barney and the kids arrive at the toy factory, being supervised by Mrs. Claus, played by Susan Largo. So, yeah. And here we see Mrs. Largo organizing the presents for that year's Christmas. We see the kids arriving with Barney. And Mrs. Claus greets them nicely. And she lets the kids explore, but not Barney. She has something to say to him first. Listen.
Barney. Santa told me you were coming over. I can't wait to show you around.
Yep, that line actually scared me a little bit, but not as much as another clip from this movie that I'll get to in a little bit. Now, this next part, I'm going to talk about the next two things that scared me at the same time, because they were from a certain episode that me and Jordan 90s fanboy both remember seeing. And I can also confirm that Justin Knight also remembers seeing this episode too. Number 7. The magic windmill stops spinning. And number 6. The head of the tubby bye-bye voice trumpet passed its turning point in balancing pots. Yep. Now, in most segments, I'm going to actually hang on a second, guys. I just want to get to in balancing pots, we know it has the magic tree. The main reason why I remember seeing this episode, though, is because I remember seeing the On Top and Underneath TV event on PBS, and I do want to bring up one other fact. The dialogue of the narrators is exactly the same as in the On Top and Underneath, as in the set episode where that TV event was from. Before I show you that, I want to show you how the voice trumpet rises normally. I'm going to use the second US version of Numbers 3. Because both it and Balancing Pots have the same boost shatter. Hang on a second. I'm not gonna show the windmill stopping here because I'm not gonna, because I don't. Oh, actually, let me move the volume here because we don't need to hear it right now. We're gonna hear in Balancing Pots, the ending of that, because I don't want to have to. So it's not really worth playing it twice. But I'm gonna show you how the voice trumpet rises normally from the bottom to the top. Watch. This is how it rises normally. We see it rising a few inches, and then when it gets halfway up, we see it turning to the right, and then we hear the speaking noise when the voice trumpet's about to say something. But in Balancing Pots, here's where things get scary. Here is where I'm going to play the windmill stop. First, we see the windmill stopping after the magic tree. And credit goes to Scooby-Doo 1998 for uploading this on archive.org. He also uploaded on YouTube originally. But wait till you see this. We see the pink sparkles disappearing. But instead of seeing we do not hear, listen to this. Yeah, we hear. Yeah, it was kind of like that. But, I mean, the fade effect was a little bit longer from what I remember on the PBS version. But Scooby-Doo 1998 did a good job demonstrating how that worked. But I will say this. That clip scared me for sure as a kid. And same with Jordan Knight's Fanboy, too. I didn't remember this until late 2020 when Jordan the 90s Fanboy brought this up in one of his older YouTube videos. And I give him big credit, and he gets huge credit for that, because thanks to him, I remember that memory came back to me. So kudos to you for that. So yeah. Number 5. Elmo saying hi in the first season of Elmo's World, and also in the Elmo's World drawing scene. Also, another thing while we're at it, I'm gonna show you how the Elmo's World segment was normally played. From season 31 through season 39. Listen. See, the page turns, and it immediately zooms into to a drawing of Elmo. See, that's how it normally plays in season 31 through 39 for episodes that originally came out in season 31, 39. In season 30, a fade effect was used. And in season 31 through 37, which had some any episode that featured any Sesame Street episode that featured Elmo's World episodes from season 30, the intro is different. Watch. As you can see, when the page turns, it doesn't zoom to Elmo immediately, and the background's different of the. I'm actually going to turn up the volume a little bit. Listen to how loud Elmo is when he says hello to the viewer in a second. And same with hello, Dorothy, his goldfish. Okay, Elmo, I get it that you're happy to see your friends, but you didn't need to be that loud, okay? You could have been a little bit calmer, okay? And then the other one, now that's not the only time he's very loud on that. The other set time he does it is during the drawing segment. I'm using this clip from episode 3924. Which also, which in that scene, it made sense to have that segment because it's about Gabby, seen here, played by Desiree Casado, who now goes by Desiree Miller, drawing a city for her mother, Maria, played by Sonia Manzano. And fun fact, I'm not going to say where, but I will tell you this. Casado graduated at a high school in a town that I had family members that lived in the same town that where some of my family members used to live. Or family friends, I should say. So that's why I've been to that town. And also, another fun fact, my lucky number is 222. And how does it relate to Gabby? Well, today she works at a school where that number is its address number. So, yeah. I just thought I'd share some cool information for you about Gabby. So, there's Gabby showing her mother her picture. And I'm actually just going to skip right to the part where because we already saw the intro. But listen to how loud Elmo is in the drawing setting when he says hello to the viewer. Okay. Well, he wasn't too loud when he said hello to Dorothy. Okay, that was a little bit better, but you still could have been calmer when you said hello to the viewers. And the next part actually also has to do with Elmo. The next thing that scared me that I put on the list. Now, this next clip, this next part also scared Jordan and I's fanboy as well. Number 4. Narf and Elmo shoving their mouths into the camera. Let's talk about... So, we'll start with Narf. In the Monster Clubhouse Goodbye song, most segments, like this one here, the triangle scene, which was shown in episode 4052, which I do remember seeing on PBS, because I remember the number of the day in the episode in that episode, which was 10. And for those that are wondering what the letter of the day was in that, it was V. I also remember the closing segment where the bagpipe guy was used. But let's listen to the Goodbye song, and then wait till you see him shoving his mouth at the end of the song. Okay. Okay. Now, Narf's not the only one that did it. Elmo does it here in the farm segment when he has something for the viewers. What is it? Elmo, take it away.
Yeah, Elmo has a question for you.
Okay. So he also did that in Malt when he, which, but that one made, but that actually, in that, that time it made sense because in that segment, he was using that as a reference to what, to give the viewers a hint of what he was referring to. But here in Farms, it just doesn't work because the way, my idea for what, the way Elmo could have said it is, and now Elmo has a question for you, like he's moving like a cow. Because you rhymes with moo. So, because cows live on a farm. That would make more sense. So, yeah. It, but shoving your mouth in, but shoving his mouth in the farm segment just doesn't cut it for me. Okay, next one. All right, here we get to... Now we get... This next one actually scared me quite a, the most in Barney's Night Before Christmas. Here we go. Number three. Keisha sang that 15-word line to the pretend Santa Claus in Night Before Christmas. Okay. I'll narrate it again. I'll narrate the scene again. Once Barney, once Hannah's parents, played by Carolyn McCormick and John Swayze, respectively, Mr. Their names are Mr. and Mrs. Morgan. Once they leave the living room and they go do their thing, Keisha wishes Santa could be there. Suddenly, we hear jingling noises and BJ pretending to be Santa Claus. And so, yeah, I'm trying to talk over because my dad in the background is on the phone right now. So I'm trying to talk over that. And we hear Steven, played by Chase Gallatin, saying that sounds like Santa Claus. And then we see and BJ arriving, coming down the stairs. And so, and then BJ introduces himself as the pretend Santa. Now, I would have probably stood and never mind that. Anyway, so we see BJ introducing himself with his clothing, and he knows that the kids want presents, and the kids think it's funny that he's pretending to be Santa. And then Hannah explains that what Santa was using was his what BJ was using was his laundry bag, and then when he asks about the cookies again, Keisha says this line that scared me. Now, before I play the clip, I will admit that I'm going to play the clip, but before I do, I'm going to say, now that I think about it and the seat I'm in right now, I regret being scared of it, and I'll explain why.
Those cookies.
Oh, but Santa, before you eat, there are so many things we'd like to hear about.
Okay, so the reason, and why do I regret being, so Mayor Baker Ramos, if you're watching this, I am sorry that you scared me in that clip. I should not have been scared of that clip. And the reason being is because the way you said it in that clip made sense. Because the way you said so actually you said it very long. The long so made it very clear to the pretend Santa that you and the rest of the kids in this scene wanted to know more about there were so many things about Santa that you were interested in learning about. But when this scene was about to show up, when I was a kid and up until 2020, I would hide in the beginning. I would hide behind a wall. And from 2012 until 2020, I would hide behind a blanket or a comforter when that clip is about to be shown. So, but once again, Mara, I sincerely apologize for being scared of you and for being scared of you saying that line in that clip, because you said it very well. So yeah, I just wasn't used to you saying the word "so" at the time, but nowadays, you did it very well. But if you think that scared me the most, wait till you see these two clips, these two parts. Number two is Number two, I'm sorry, I'm trying to talk over my dad because he's still on the telephone. Number two, fire alarms, lockdown drills, and tornado drills. Basically, yes, I understand that many states require schools and large business areas to do fire drills at least a certain amount of times in a year. But it's just that the fire alarm noise, even though it makes sense, is scary. But I'm going to use this KNCOMSB talking alarm smoke test as an example of how loud it is, because that's actually the alarm I have in my home. In fact, I have one up on the ceiling of my room, because it's required in my home state of Massachusetts that every room of residence has to have a fire and smoke alarm. And they also have to be replaced every 10 years as well while we're at it. So let's listen to the smoke alarm. I'm gonna try not to keep it too loud. Fire, fire, fire. Okay, and credit for this goes to Leecon Electric's company for uploading this clip. So, and another fun fact is that alarm also was the one used for my previous group home. Fun fact. I thought I'd give you another fun fact there. But I will tell you this, that one. There was one time when they did it on November 20th, 2022, when it just, the timing that they did it just didn't work for me, because it occurred at 1:00 PM that Sunday when I was about to watch an NFL game, which for those that are wondering, was the New York Jets and New England Patriots, because my favorite announcer, Kevin Harlan, was assigned that game that week. So I felt very upset with them. And at that point, that's when I kind of started leaning towards cutting ties with them. I was kind of leaning that way anyway. Actually, it started November 7th for something different, but yeah, I just felt like I was starting to slowly cut ties with them. Eventually, I did that in May of this year. I'm not gonna talk more about that because that's off topic in this video. Maybe I'll talk about another video. And finally, what was the scariest thing that scared me the most on this list? Let's see. Number one, let's try again. Number one is, I'll give you a clip, it's something in Teletubbies, related, and Jordan 90's fanboy, I'm on your side about this one. The baby son's crescendo scream. We heard the diminuendo, we started with the diminuendo scream, and we're ending this list with the crescendo scream, because that's the scream that scared me the most as a kid. And I'm using the U.S. version of Drumming with Norris, because this is the episode I remember, besides Tubby Bye Bye, this is the episode I remember seeing the baby son crescendo screaming outside of Tubby Bye Bye. And it happens after the stamping and stepping dance, which, fun fact, was the first dance the Teletubbies ever filmed. So, and this was actually done in one take. Another fun fact I should mention about this in the YouTube clip. I'm not going to talk too much about what I learned in the book called Over the Hills and Far Away, My Life as a Teletubby. I'm only mentioning those two facts because it makes sense. Because since I'm mentioning the stamping and stepping dance already, I thought I'd just tell you those two fun facts. So anyway, and that's why you see them doing it, you see the same takes when they do the extended version. Even though the music is different in most episodes except the US version of Balloon Umbrella. Now, after we see the close-up of Lala, which actually did creep me out a little bit, that close-up of Lala, which you're going to see that in a moment. Watch. Okay, Jeff Smith, do your crescendo scream. Now, that's not the only clip I'm going to show you, because there's actually an extended version of her doing it from Naughty Cloud. I believe the UK version of Carnival After the TV and Making a Den. This clip, if I had seen this in the US, I would have had a heart attack if I saw this clip, because this scream is so long. Listen. Actually, now that I'm listening to it, it sounds like it's slowed down. I don't think that's extended at this point. It might be slowed down. She goes, because it sounded like it was a little slower. So as you can hear, we hear the baby son, like, screaming low, and then she screams out loud. And yes, I do agree with you, Jordan Ice fanboy, on her face right when she's about to do the scream. Like, she looks to the bottom right side of the screen, and like, her face was a little unsettling there, and the scream just makes it worse, especially if the crescendo scream. The diminuendo scream did kind of scare me a little bit, but the crescendo scream was the one that like, crossed the line for me and Jordan Ice fanboy, with the exception of Tubby Bye Bye, because you're used to it. So yeah, which happens after the last Teletubby, say goodbye the third time before they jump into into their dome. Those are the top 13 things that scared me as a kid. And thank you all for watching. Happy Halloween, and until next time, don't get scared.